The GM's words are the player's window into the game world. There are performance-enhancing tools you can use, like pictures, miniatures, and maps, but the heavy lifting will still boil down to what you say and how you say it. This, of course, is storytelling, and there are a virtually infinite number of storytelling techniques you can use to vividly bring your game world to life for the players. There's no limit to where the art of storytelling will take you, but in the crucible of the table, it can be useful to have a few tried-and-true techniques you can fall back on. So that's where we'll start today. Simple formulas that will empower you to create descriptions that are efficient, effective, evocative, and also easy. Let's start with a room in a dungeon. When describing a dungeon room, start by listing every notable thing in the room and its position. Now, notable here can be broadly understood as the stuff that the PCs will check out, interact with, or which will inform their actions. Second, use the 3 of 5 rule to drop descriptive tags onto some or all of the notable things you just listed. The short version of the 3 of 5 rule is that you should think about your 5 senses and try to include at least 3 of them in your description. Now, sight is a gimme, and taste will rarely apply, so that usually means picking a couple out of hearing, smell, and touch. Now, remember that you don't actually have to touch something to intuit what it might feel like if you did. Touch can also include things like wind and temperature. Now finally, if appropriate, add a verb. In other words, add action to the scene. For example, instead of saying, there's a waterfall, you could say, a waterfall tumbles down the far wall. Now, in other words, what you're doing here is listing things in the scene, a wardrobe, a bookshelf, a goblin, and then dropping a descriptive tag and a verb on some or all of them. A horrid stench, smell, emanates from a wardrobe off to your left. On the opposite side of the room, there's a bookshelf stuffed full, sight, of thick tomes and tightly wrapped scrolls. There's a goblin pawing through the books, knocking them to the ground, verb. Seeing you, the goblin gapes its maw and screeches. That's a sound. And that's your 3 of 5, your verb and your formula for describing a dungeon room. We can also use a description formula for NPCs, whether we're improvising them or prepping a universal NPC role-playing template, which I'll link to in the Font of All Knowledge down below. First, include an action, something that the NPC is doing. Second, what are they wearing? And third, include one physical trait. For example, Lady Silva is wearing a beautiful blue dress, clothing, that complements her sapphire eyes, the physical trait. She taps her finger thoughtfully on her chin while looking you up and down. In action. Now, if you're using the Universal NPC role-playing template, the NPC's action may be drawn from the role-playing section of the template. In other words, the action may be the NPC's common mannerism that they do all the time. But it doesn't have to be. And the key thing is that you're establishing the NPC as someone living in the world. You're not describing a portrait hanging in a gallery. You're establishing them in the scene. They are doing something. When encountering a hostile monster, we can use a slightly different formula to quickly bring them to life. First, look at their abilities and attacks. Describe how one or more of these are physically manifest. Second, describe one non-ability-based physical trait. If you're coming up dry on this, you can use ability scores for inspiration. Monsters with high strength scores are bulky or muscular, high dexterity scores are lithe or nimble, and so forth. Finally, add a verb. Once again, an action that puts both the monster and the scene into motion, creating a flow of time that propels the players to react to what's happening. Let's pick a few monsters at random from the monster manual and see how this plays out in practice. First, we have a hill giant. They have a great club and a rock attack. You could include the club in your description. Alternatively, you could mention that they're standing near a pile of rubble from which you can later describe them snatching up rocks to throw at interlopers. They're a giant, so they're quite tall. You know, you don't actually have to make this complicated. What could the giants be doing? Gnawing a bone, scratching their head, chatting amongst themselves, swatting at the giant flies swarming around their heads? Again, you don't have to be particularly clever. Just establish the idea and move into the scene. Okay, let's find another monster. How about the revenant? I can see that one of their abilities is vengeful glare. So let's describe them as having eyes that burn with an eerie blue light. They're undead and have an 18 charisma, so we can add that it's incredibly handsome, with chalky gray-white skin. Now we can simply add an action that's appropriate to the current scene, and we're done. As with our other formulas, of course, you shouldn't get hung up on the order here. The description of the Revenant, for example, could be a dark figure perched atop a rocky promontory, gazing out across the valley. The man's features are handsome, but his eyes burn with an eerie blue light, and his skin is a chalky gray-white. Let's put the monster manual down now and grab a completely different monster. How about a xenomorph? Their acid blood isn't immediately obvious, but maybe we could riff on the idea of bodily fluids by having their jaws slavering with some alien bile. Their serrated tail whips back and forth while the flickering fluorescent lights gleam off their black, chitinous exoskeleton. It's pretty easy to imagine coming up with similar formulas for other elements of a particular setting or game that you find yourself struggling with, either at the table or during prep. For your own formulas, here are a few things you should keep in mind. First, what is essential? What do the players need to know to understand, interact with, and even remember this element of the game? Second, what can I use as a source of inspiration, like the 3 of 5 rule or using monster abilities? And third, keep the formula short. All of these formulas include 3 elements, and that's not really a coincidence. You could do 4 or maybe even 5 elements, but at some point the formula simply becomes unwieldy. Ideally, these formulas should be simple enough that you can remember them. But when you're getting comfortable with a formula for the first time, you can also jot it down on a post-it note as a practice point and attach it to your GM screen. Of course, formulas are ultimately, well, formulaic. They'll only take you so far, and they can easily become repetitive. It's also trivial to find examples where a generic formula will be a poor fit for the needs of a specific scene or character. The role of these formulas is not to be the be-all or end-all of RPG descriptions, but if you're stuck, you can use them as simple recipes to get your brain churning. In fact, you'll often find that starting with a formula will quickly inspire you to spin out of the mold and create something completely different from the formula. And if it does, mission accomplished. These formulas are tools, not straitjackets. And as you're looking to expand beyond the simple formulas, one thing to keep in mind is that description should persist throughout the scene. I've mentioned in the past that the legacy of box text can condition GMs to think of description as something that you can only do at the beginning of a scene or when the PCs enter a room. But that's an artificial limitation of published modules that you should try to move beyond as you're running the game. This persistent description can take several forms, all of which are used in response to the PC's actions. First, you can add sensory details. You mentioned that there was broken glass on the floor, which is sight, but as the PCs move into the room, you can add the description of the glass crunching under their boots, which adds both sound and touch. You describe the waterfall as roaring, which is hearing, but you can build on that by mentioning the cool mist it throws up, touch, or the fractured reflections of light dancing across the walls of the cave, which is sight. Second, you can provide additional details in response to investigation. When the rogue heads over to check out the wardrobe, you can take the opportunity to describe the intricate carvings on its doors. After seeing Lady Silver for the first time, the PCs grab their drinks and head over to talk to her. Now you can take the opportunity to add the color of her hair as she turns to look at them. In the case of a keyed dungeon room, these additional details are often structured and prepped. Remember how we listed each notable thing in the room? When the PCs go to investigate or interact with each notable thing, that action simply triggers additional details. Of course, the PCs can also discover entirely new things in the environment as they explore it that weren't mentioned in the initial description. A secret door is the classic example here. Also, what's inside the wardrobe and causing that terrible smell? Matryoshka techniques, which we discussed a bit in our previous video on Matryoshka clues, can be a powerful way for running this. I'll include a link to that video in the Font of All Knowledge. Now, fourth, you can introduce new elements tangentially. A cold wind blows through a cracked window. An Atyog shambles through the door. A police siren wails past the apartment building. A flickering hologram manifests in the center of the chamber. You don't have to wait for the PCs to investigate to add something new to the scene. The world, after all, is a dynamic and active place. Finally, you can combine any or all of these techniques. Now, for example, someone throws a rock with a note wrapped around it through the window. As Brian goes to pick up the rock, describe the crunch of broken glass under his feet. He discovers that the rock itself is black obsidian. As he pulls the note off the rock, describe the texture of the vellum. An image I find particularly evocative is to think of the description of the game world as being layered. You don't have to describe every single detail of an environment in one big glob of exposition. Make sure that the players have the key information they need to orient themselves and understand what's happening. but then either peel back or add on, whichever visual analogy works better for you. Add on additional layers of description as the scene plays out, slowly building up the mental image of the place like a painter laying down paint on their canvas. Now, speaking of layers, here's an extra tip when it comes to describing monsters. The first time the players encounter a monster, you need to establish the monster's basic visual image. And obviously, you can use the formula we just talked about to do that. But once the players are familiar with a monster and are able to put a name to it, you know, goblins, gelatinous cubes, blood terrors, little fuzzies, you don't need to re-establish the monster's basic description every time. This can lead you into a trap, though, of replacing evocative description with bland labels. You see six goblins. What you want to do instead, once the players know what a monster is, in other words, when you can say it's a warg and they know what that means, you want to dig one layer deeper by customizing the monster. These aren't just six goblins. They're six goblins dressed in opera dresses. This isn't just a warg, it's a warg with a bright red scar over its left eye. This yeti's fur is matted and filthy. This ogre's hair is tied in a topknot. This ghoul's left arm is broken and its hand flops back and forth on a loose flap of sinew. When the PCs run into a mob of monsters, you don't need to customize every single one of them, of course. In fact, it's probably counterproductive. As a rule of thumb, though, you'll either want to customize one of them. For example, it's a group of yetis and one of them is wearing a sapphire amulet. Or focus on what's notable about all of them. For example, all of these yetis are missing a finger on their left hand. Now, if you're making one member of a group stand out, it will often be the leader, but this isn't necessarily true. For example, one warg out of the pack might be limping and ostracized by the others. Now, for humanoids, you might use the full formula for an NPC described above, but for monsters, you often just need one salient detail to distinguish them. Now, if you'd like to see more great descriptions, check out DSCRYB, the sponsors of today's video. Their site includes vivid descriptions created by an incredible team of professional RPG designers, as well as interactive maps, character illustrations, and an incredible sonic library that includes Foundry VTT integration. Whether you're looking for a little inspiration, or just the missing piece you need to make your next adventure perfect, you may find it hiding over at DSCRYB. I've included a link to their free resources in the Font of All Knowledge down below. While you're down there, make an opportunity attack on the subscribe button. I've got some really great videos coming up, including some deep dives into my upcoming book, So You Want to Be a Game Master, that you won't want to miss. Good gaming. I'm Justin Alexander, and I'll see you at the table.